And for all of that, I got my Padma Shri.
Yeah. Recommended by the Governor of Goa.
You can see an extremely tall ex-president. I could not stand on the same step as him because of the, it will not reach the medal. And then even better than this, I did a job for the Académie Française in Paris. Do you know in India, abroad, they have only 7 garments they can play with. Okay, it's all actually rubbish. They just have a blouse, skirt, pant, jacket, cocktail dress and evening dress. Okay, whereas in India, every state has got a wide cupboard of clothing that they can pull out. So what happened was the French people said, can you do us translations for each, whether it's a ghagra, how you spell it, would spell it in French, etc. I helped them with that project. Then I would help them with all the French people that my partner is still in charge of them. If there's an if there is an evacuation emergency in the country, he's going to take one plane load off back to France. And I also, we helped them to identify dead bodies who died in Goa, whether they are some French people who are in jail, negotiate their release, etc., etc. So for all of that, the government of France gave me a knighthood in the order of arts and letters. Oops, sorry. And I'm glad I didn't get the Legion d'Honneur because that is given like confetti around. This is where more difficult to get. The knighthood in the arts of in the order of arts and letters includes a very long illustrious list like T.S. Eliot and Audrey Hepburn and lots of other luminaries. So that was on a French ship where the ambassador flew around from Delhi and gave me that award. And this is I'm winding down. This is our house, our ex-house. Our ex-house, which I said, what are we doing with this big house for two gay men in this house and cats and dogs living in all the bedrooms? So let's make it into a museum. So my book, Moda Goa, is going to become a museum. We have completed half the job. We have converted a 4-bedroom house, which was a home, into 16 galleries now. And we are planning to open by the end of the year. So we've collected and got us donations, some exquisite jewelry, gold, which is from the early 17th century, saris. Rita Faria, this is Asia's first Miss World. Rita Faria is a Goan who comes from a village just next to me. And when she heard about my museum, she donated her swimsuit, her 3 sashes of Miss Bombay, Miss India and Miss World for the museum. And she kept the shoes. She said she never walked in those high heel shoes again. So we are getting the whole thing from her. We also have one room dedicated to all the festivals of Goa, which not many people know much about. And that's how the museum will finally look when it's completed.
Brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
Actually, it looks like that. So we said, let's give it as a legacy. What can we give to Goa and the country? And we are going to be the first costume museum in India. So we are enjoying the support of the Ministry of Textiles and also the Ministry of Culture. So please wish us well and pray for us that it becomes true.
You know, Wendell, you have shared elaborately with us all these influences that you've had in your life, you know, and that have got you where you are today. But could you share with us, just for the students especially, just the major factors that influenced your sense of fabric, your sense of design, just the major ones that played that important role that pushed you?
Do you know, I learned a lot of techniques in Paris, and one of the things that I learned was how to make a collection look new. You have to start from the foundation. I start by not going out and buying silk which is ready-made in the market. We start weaving. We weave our fabric. I mean, what I'm wearing today is a million stitches done by a tribal, which Rajiv Sethi got done for me. It took 6 months to make this. They're all tiny, tiny stitches. You know, if you have to innovate, you have to innovate internationally. It has to look new. Somebody from Paris, whether it's Stella McCartney or whether it is whoever it is, will look at this jacket and say, wow, can I touch it? What is it made of? Mm-hmm. And I think when you start from foundation, from fabric, and then you have to learn how to cut. Because if you don't know how to cut, you can never cut a new sleeve pattern. You can never cut a new body pattern. You can never do that that book page, what I call the book page dress. You could not do the gown that Pia wore. You just have to learn how to cut and love it and make new patterns from it. And then your entire collections will look nice. Please do not do, you know, clothes that are like for meant for Bollywood or, you know, with fancy dress or too tight. This is not in our culture. It has to go away in a new silhouette. And you have to make sure when you're doing your graduation collection, please make sure that you do a collection of 7 garments or 8 garments, which you can show to ensemble or to Glitterati or to whichever place so that they can sell it. It must sell. It has to be worn, and you have to get the pleasure of entering a party and seeing someone wear it.
Brilliant. Thanks. You know, actually, that was my next question, Wendell, that fashion is nowadays so influenced by Bollywood that I think somewhere we're losing our true sense of fashion. So thank you very much for pointing out that don't chase what you see in Bollywood. Bollywood is an industry of its own, correct? And fashion is its own.
Pia, to a point, you know, Bollywood is very important. It's like Hollywood is to the Western world.
Correct.
And also you have to admit that Bollywood has changed. I remember when I was growing up, I would never want to wear clothes like Jitendra or Govinda.
Of course.
That wasn't going to happen. And I'm laughing because it's true. But you know, I'll tell you, when these girls won, I remember when Aishwarya won and when Sushmita won, they said, we are not going to let those people touch our hair and face. They took Mickey Contractor and all the fashion people.
Yes.
They said, we are not even going to wear those clothes. So they took designers. And people like Sabyasachi did films.
So do you think that we should be influenced by Bollywood?
No, I don't think we should be influenced by Bollywood. It is a reverse case. Bollywood should be influenced by us. Because we are the future of fashion. We are looking ahead. We are showing what's going to come into the stores 6 months later. So they need to look at us. It's like, you know, I remember when they were doing the movie Out of Africa and I was involved with a stylist over there because I met her and she became my friend and she is from Bollywood. She said when she did the costumes, she actually wrote in her trend book that these safari clothes are going to become popular in 6 months when this movie comes out. So she was on top of it.
Brilliant.
And I think that is what we need to do. We need to set the trend and let them follow us, even though in the end what's going to happen is the public is going to follow them because they've seen it on them on the screen first.
Absolutely.
They've not seen it at our fashion show.
Absolutely.
Few people saw it and few people wrote about it and few people wear it.
Absolutely.
But in the end, we are the influencers.
Yes, thank you. Also, with global warming and, us now slowly becoming aware of our environment, a lot of brands are moving to environment sustainability. Yes, thank you. So how do young designers achieve that? How do they make sure that what they're doing is environmental friendly?
There are two things. Firstly, there's a book called To Die For by Lucy Segal. You must read that book. In that book, Lucy Segal, who has become a kind of an activist now for slow fashion, tells you how to make one cotton t-shirt, it takes 2 tons of water. And no matter whether you're doing polyester, even if you're doing wool, we don't have enough grazing grounds on the earth for the sheep to feed on. We do not have enough silkworms and mulberry trees to feed on. So please do not buy fast fashion. Please do not buy when you're buying clothes. Your contribution can start with you buy clothes that will last and you don't wear and throw away like fast fashion has become today. Don't order online just because it costs 200 rupees. Please, you are polluting the planet and you are using up the world's resources.
after sharing all this amazing knowledge with us, what do you think is the next trend, really?
I think the next trend is what you just said, it is going to be eco-friendly. Because I think the people have discovered with global warming is on everybody's lips and the minute you get a new fabric out, like for example, we had Uzrama, I don't know, for those who know about Malka cotton, she actually ignores the baling process and takes the tribals to the field and they start to make the thread and the spools right there at the edge of the field. And when you wear that cotton, you actually feel a spring and a bounce because it's not been pressed. I think what will also become a big trend is hand wovens. More and more people are discovering that no matter what people will say about, you know, our clothes, I mean, this has gotten to a stage where they are making now Kanjivarams in China. This has to stop. We just need to feel that beauty. When I wear this kind of achkan, I feel the beauty of the tribal's hands that made it. And we really need to look at it that way because we are the only people in the world, I have to tell you this, we are the only country in the world that is still wearing our 6,000-year-old legacy of clothing. Everybody has forgotten it. The Chinese have abandoned it. Japanese have abandoned it. They wear their ceremonial clothes for one tea ceremony or a wedding thing or whatever it is. But India wears its clothes, especially the ladies. All our ladies, give yourself a round of applause. Our Indian ladies, unlike the men who are influenced by the British and wear trousers and shirts, I salute all those men who wear kurtas. And all those men who wear Indian. Because I'm fed up of saying that, oh, you know, you are an executive, so you have to go to work in a tie and a pant and shirt and suit. You can work better maybe in a kurta. And our children's school uniforms, please change them. Please make them wear a kurta pajama and not like as though they are in Scotland with their shirts tucked in and long john socks. And one bow tie or tie, God knows what they wear.
Absolutely. Why hasn't anybody thought of that? I would have loved to wear a kurta in school. It would be so easy.
I redesigned the Sharda Mandir school uniforms in Goa. You will not believe it. Not only the children were happy because they felt so much more free. The parents were happy. They said, Wendell, thank you for doing this shirt. No buttons, no nothing. Just wear it on. Yeah, and just make the children feel free. And this whole thing of us, you know, imitating the West or whatever, the West is rubbish. Please understand this. There's no, don't follow trends, don't follow forecasts. They are so stupid, really they are so stupid, that they'll say, now the purple is the new black. Thankfully, Indian women, if purple makes them look sick, they are not going to wear that purple. That's smart
enough.
Thank God. Yeah. Then they'll say, minis are in fashion. Then if you have bad knees, then you have to still wear where they were. You go to the shop, you'll have only minis. Only tight pants. Only this. We have tailors. We have intelligence. Let us celebrate the diversity of this lovely big country. Wear all the colors. Don't listen to them and say, let them tell you pink is the new in fashion, whatever it is. Wear what you want to wear. Wear what makes you happy. And celebrate this great country.
Brilliant. You know, before I open the floor to everybody, I just wanted to point out, in the beginning you said, reach for the stars, go international, you know, that's what you should be aiming for. But it is intimidating, you know, you don't know how you're going to break into that market. So how do you, as a budding designer or a singer or any field that you choose, how do you find your spot in a global market?
Pia, I think I did not explain it properly enough. I am not saying go to their market. Their market.
No.
What I am saying is be internationally new. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
You can be internationally new for India. You can be internationally new for the world. But be internationally new. Something that has never been done before.
Yes. Get influenced by your country, your things, your tradition.
Their market is so small. We have 1.2 billion people that we can dress.
Absolutely.
Who wants their market? I've been to Europe and to Paris and whatever. I mean, I'll give you a perfect example of how it works for them, okay? Because they have these weather cycles and whatever, it works for them. For us, it doesn't work. to show a collection in October for spring summer of next year, I have to start weaving in May minimum. I start weaving in May, I start dyeing in June, then I start doing the designs in July, then I get ready, I make all the clothes in August, by September we shoot the lookbook, blah blah blah, then we go to show it in October. Then we get the orders. After we get the orders, then we have to wait till they want the delivery in February or March. How many months have gone? May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, January, February. 10 months your money is atkaud over there, stuck. In India, aaj banao, kal biko.
Superb. Thank you so much, Wendell. This has been amazing. Anyone has any questions? Sure.
She needs a mic.
No, I'm loud
enough. Oh, okay. Yeah. Don't say poskem, it's called poskem. Because in Konkani and in Portuguese, we don't pronounce the M. So when you land in Goa, don't say you want to go to Kandulim. They'll know that you're an outsider and they'll charge you double the taxi. Don't say you want to go to Morjim, Mandrem. It's poskem, with the N nasal sound. Sorry. That was just a tip for you not to get ripped off by the taxi wallahs. Yeah. The book is available on Amazon, and it's not expensive. The book is about a very shameful tradition where Goans would adopt, from rich houses especially, would adopt poor children. Sometimes the children were given by the poor parents, or sometimes they were orphans, or sometimes they came from, I don't know, orphanages or whatever. Sometimes, I'm not saying always, sometimes they were treated very well, like normal children. They gave them the surname of the house and everything. Sometimes they were not treated well. Sometimes they were treated as servants and slaves for the rest of their lives. Sometimes, like in the book, you'll hear about one of them who is treated as a sex object. The son sleeps with her and the father of the house also sleeps with her. And then they would not give them inheritance rights, for example. They would not treat them, even though they had other children in the house, they would not give them land or house or whatever it is. Worst of it all was some of them were purposely not married. And I had one such poskem living opposite me in my old house, which is now the museum. And they didn't let her get married. That poor Rosa didn't get married. And they kept her a spinster so that she would always look after the house. She wouldn't run away and look after her own husband or family. So, but that is the sad part of parts of the book. When Rosa died, I promised at her coffin I was going to write a story about the poskems of Goa. And I did write the book, and but the story was so dark, I said I have to lighten it up. So I lightened it up with, there are 22 recipes in the book. All are authentic, all turn out delicious. And I did not want to go into explaining about the houses of Goa and the cities of Goa or whatever. So I went to Mario Miranda's widow, Habiba, and he said, Habiba, can you give me Mario's sketches? Because Mario's sketches so perfectly depict Goa. And so you have those illustrations as well, which fluffed up the book and made my editor feel very happy that it was not a thin book anymore. Welcome.
Anyone else? Any questions? Yes?
Actually, there is a preschool in Jaipur that only allows the children to wear kurta pajama.
Can we know the name so we can applaud them?
It's called the Loharu Montessori School.
Oh, good.
And since my children are 2.5, 2.5, they have to wear the kurta pajama to school every day. The point that I'm coming down to is the principal, a very forward looking lady who wants the children to be comfortable. Heirloom clothing to people.
do you know, I had this problem with that one school I was talking to you about. When I designed the new uniform, we had the same kind of problem where, you know, people said, parents said, oh, you know, it looks so simple, it looks so Indian, why can't we look like, this is the most expensive school of Goa. So I told them, I said, okay, it's fine. I said, we are going to have a exercise with one class. We told the students, you will wear the Wendell Rodriguez kind of design kurta and pant for 3 days, and you will wear that other uniform for 3 days. Then we'll ask the students themselves, which one do you all want? So they all went for the Indian one. They could run better, they could play better, they could sit on the ground, they could, they were very happy with it. They didn't have to tuck their shirt in and make sure it stayed tucked in here, that they raised their hand, the shirt would come out. So yeah, it was cool.
And a tie and a sash and 500 things, that's what we wore in school.
Rubbish. And that's which brings me to another point, okay? Our Indian education system, can I use a word? Yeah, I can. It's not bad. Sucks. Yeah. I'll tell you, really. You know, I grew up, I'm not saying don't learn about the Boston Tea Party and Henry VIII and whatever it is. But we can't learn our own history properly. I had to learn about the Deccan Muslim Sultans from Manu Pillai's book, which came out last year. I learned more about Jahangir from Parvati Sharma's new book, which also came out last year. I mean, why are they teaching us, at least now, thank God, they are teaching us yoga in school. Earlier, we had what is called PT, you know, PT class.
I had PT, I never had yoga.
Ridiculous. I mean, we are still stuck in a colonial hang-up. We are, unfortunately, our syllabuses have not been written or rewritten to bring and celebrate our Indianness properly. You teach our Indianness, I mean, you know, I'm so ashamed. My Goans don't know how to make, girls don't even know in college how to make a prawn curry. When they learn it, I don't know. They don't even know how to sing our Konkani songs. I said, they can sing the latest Bollywood songs, they can sing all the English songs, they can't sing a Konkani song. They don't know Konkani stories. I said, I went to the education minister, I said, we have to change the syllabus because it's rubbish. Why can't they learn how to compost? You have one dustbin and throw everything in that dustbin. Whether it's banana skins, I said, we can easily have three of them. And then you can take those three at the end of the day, put it in the compost pit. We'll show you how to put EM on it and convert it into manure for your lawn or for your trees in the school. So that whole system has to change. If somebody made me education minister, I would change it overnight.
Thank you.
Did you see that article I wrote to our PWD minister that went viral about bikinis, because he wanted to stop bikinis on Goa beach? Just Google Wendell Rodriguez bikinis minister and a little pop up. I told him to shut up. I said, because you will have to go to your office if you are saying this is not Indian. Please take out your shirt. Please take out your pant. The pant came from Central Asia. The shirt came from Europe. Take out your belt. We didn't have belts. Take off your shoes. Wear a dhoti and go to work. Not in your BMW or Mercedes-Benz. In a bullock cart. Okay? And when you reach there, sir, throw out the chairs, throw out the table, throw out the computer, the telephone, that Mont Blanc in your pocket. Throw everything out and sit on a patla and start writing on a banana leaf. Because even paper came from China. Get Pia to wear it.
All right. I will.
She's always posting her Instagram pictures of herself in the bikini.
Well, you know, I started my career being a Kingfisher swimsuit calendar model. So I have always been that. And I'm very happy to help you anytime. Please don't feel discouraged at all. Like he said, you have your eye.
I'll tell you one more thing. This is not for only fashion. This is for everything. You know, people keep on telling you or convincing you that the real answer at the end of it all is to make money. It is so untrue. What matters is happiness. When you are happy, that is more wealth that you can ever have. So strive to be happy. I changed my job. I'm a hotel management student. I worked 6 years in that industry. My mother, when I passed out my 12th standard, was mighty disappointed. She went and applied to KEM Hospital and to Nair Hospital. And I told her, I said, Mom, I'm not going to become a doctor. I don't want to see sick people for the rest of my life or bad teeth for the rest of my life. I found one lady who came for that career orientation program from Catering College. And she was so beautiful, Mrs. Panthaki, and so beautifully dressed. I said, I'm joining that college, just based on how she looked. And my mother was horrified. She said, my God, you're going to do a Goan profession. You're going to become a cook. And I said, yeah, so. But I said, I won't become a cook. I'll become a hotel manager. But she didn't get it. Later on, when I went to the Middle East, I came from a very poor family. Okay, this is what you see now is not what I was. I was born in a chawl in Bombay, and I went with a lota in my hand to wash my backside in a public toilet. And the toilet was never washed in 3-4 months. Only on some special days, Diwali, Christmas, whatever, they used to wash it. And I said, I'm never going to be poor again. We left that house when I was 9 years old. And I said, I'm going to work so hard, I'm going to make a success of myself. And then later on, when I got fed up of saying, yes, sir, no, sir, she knows she had a restaurant. I said, I don't want to do this thing. It's like too hard work. I was working from like 6 in the morning to sometimes 2 at night. So I said, I want to become a fashion designer. And only my partner did not laugh. Everybody else laughed or said, yeah, this is a dream. So then later on, I saved. First 2 years, I gave my family all the money because we were middle class. Second 2 years, I saved everything for myself. I saved $27,000 and I went to America to study fashion. And by that time, my mother thought I had completely lost the plot. She said, from one Goan profession to another, now he's going to become a tailor. Like Goan, she said, I can see the signboard that says Rodericks and Sons, Outfitters and Tailors. Well, I proved her very wrong. She didn't know what hit her when I became famous. And suddenly she had Aishwarya Rai in her house and she had Lara Dutta. And then to make matters even worse, she got tongue-tied if there was a Simone Tata that came or a Vijay Mallya that came. So it's, in the end, she said, you did very well for yourself.
Anyone else? Yes, that's the last one.
In 2013, in BLF, in Bangalore Literature Fest, you suggested some 10 books of that.
Yes.
So, it's been 5 years now. So, is there any update of in your suggestions, like, or any book that can help us in pattern making that scares the most of us?
Pattern making, you'll have to wait for my book. But I could add a lot to those 10 books now, yeah. I have the largest collection of fashion books in the country. I'm very proud of it. And it's going to go into the museum because we have a library where you can go and do research. I have books. I remember one of the books costed about 40-something thousand and I still bought it because it contained every khadi sample in India that was ever made. It's a thick book, about maybe 6 or 8 inches thick. And it's got all these swatches inside them.
Superb. So just to close, Wendell, would you have any advice for FDCR, how they should go about with the designers, with the structure, anything that you'd like to advise them for?
I must congratulate these people behind this venture. I'll tell you why. When I agreed to come and talk, I felt, do you know, in fashion shows, we just do our show and run away. We take a very small learning experience. Here, in this event, I think they need to advise FDCI and Lakme Fashion Week. Because we are learning so much with these lectures, or I'm presuming that we are learning so much, because there is an honest conversation and a bigger take-home value.
Absolutely.
So I would like to congratulate them, and I think maybe they should become advisory consultants in this area.
Thank you so much, Wendell, for joining us and being so inspiring. And thank you so much to our lovely audience. Thank you for being here.
Thank you very much, all of you. Be happy. Make your state and your country proud. Jai Hind.